Hey everyone, welcome to episode 44 of Pixel Feet Radio, and I'm here with my friend Lisa Krasalik. Lisa, how you doing?
I am great. How are you?
I'm doing all right, doing all right. For those of you that don't know, well, first of all, thank you for coming on. And for those of you that don't know about Lisa, she has over 30 years of experience as an in the health and wellness industry, and the last 17 as an entrepreneur. And a very successful business owner. She actually specializes in mentoring health, fitness, wellness, and nutrition professionals through a program that she helped that helps develop their marketing systems and trust building, sales, and all that good stuff. Sales systems and all that good stuff. So, I wanted to bring her on. We just did a podcast together for someone else. That's how we met. And she's kicking ass, man. And she knows her funnels. So I wanted to talk to her, bring her on, tell her story, and maybe you guys can pick up, you know, some pointers there for the health and wellness industry. All right. So the first question that I always ask is, how did you become an entrepreneur? Were you one of those kids who was selling stuff on the side and started like side businesses all the time until one hit? How did that happen?
You know, that is a great question. And I'm so glad because I actually, you know, it's crazy. I was in corporate for many years, and I'll share that real quick, but I was always an entrepreneur. I actually went through a program. I don't know if you've ever heard of Junior Achievement. Junior Achievement is an amazing organization that's throughout the US, and it teaches kids about entrepreneurism. It teaches them about business. And I originally went to Junior Achievement in high school because I wanted to graduate early, and you got extra high school credit for going.
Right.
And changed my world. Like, it was amazing. I'm a huge proponent of Junior Achievement. And if you have kids that are in middle school to high school, it's all about business and entrepreneurism. So it's interesting that you had asked that. Now, after high school and college, I went to college. I got a degree in exercise physiology with a minor in business administration and marketing. And I always thought that I was going to work for professional sports teams. That was my goal. Like, I thought that's what I was going to do. And that's what I was aiming for. And as you guys know, things don't usually work out the way we plan.
No.
And I was in Oregon at the time, and they were in a deep recession. So getting any kind of job like that was impossible. So, crazy story, you know, long sort of roundabout story, I ended up working in law. And 20 years in law, and I worked my way up, literally starting from the very beginning. I started managing law firms. I became an award-winning law firm marketer, and was a total techno geek. I always have been. So I managed an IT department. I managed the marketing department, and I worked with several large law firms in Southern California. Did some work with the American Bar Association and got earned some awards. And, you know, I was kind of going down that whole corporate path, but I always had one foot still in the health and fitness industry. So I was an instructor for everything from swimming, martial arts, spinning, aerobics, like you name it, I taught, like whatever. So I always was involved in the industry, but I had gone off, you know, on another path until I met my husband. My husband was the head nutritionist, or he's a dietitian actually, at the Sports Club LA, Sports Club Irvine. So it was a very high level private health club. And some dear friends of mine were his clients, and they're like, you have to go see Luto. And I'm like, who's this Luto dude? long story short, we connected up, and he decided to, you know, branch off and go off on his own. So I became the you know, behind the scenes person, and we started our company in 2003. And initially, he was seeing clients as a dietitian, and then we ended up getting a full brick and mortar health and wellness center down in Orange County, California, in the hub of everything. And we opened up our full health and wellness center, all kinds of services. We had sub tenants and chiropractors and estheticians and personal trainers and all that stuff within a thing. And then 2008, 2009 hit.
Oh. Yeah, we all know that one well. I told the story of my 2009, 2010 plenty of times on this podcast. So yeah.
You got it. And yeah. You know what? 95, 98% of our clientele was in the mortgage industry.
Oh God,
so yeah. We lost our business basically overnight.
Wow.
So we literally shut down our office and we moved everything virtual in 2009. And we have literally been working virtually since then.
So it's like a blessing in disguise. It's like for me, mine was a blessing in disguise too, because I was not happy towards the end there. I wasn't even happy with my business. I hate it every day. I talked about this on here before. Like I started a car restoration business when I was 23 and I had it for 8 years or something like that in Dallas. And I thought I was going to love it because I was obsessed with cars and I still am to a point, but after being in that business, it's like, whatever, you know? And I thought I was going to, I love cars. So I'm going to love this. And oh man, loving cars and dealing with car dealerships and all those guys, it's not fun. So by the second year, I hated it. Oh. And I just kept doing it for the money. And then when the economy crashed, that was the excuse. I was like, you know what? I don't have to go back. I was like, I'll figure something else out. And that's when I'm like completely changed my path per se. But it was like a blessing because I couldn't be any happier now. I'm so happy right now. Are you kidding me? I'm living the dream basically.
Absolutely. It changed everything. And what happened in 2008, 2009, 2010, positioned us to what's going on now. Like this is, you know, not only it positioned us to be able to, like, this hasn't been a big shift for us, but we also work with our clients. We started letting them know about 2 years ago, we knew there was a recession coming. And so we started helping them set up their businesses in a way that they were perfectly positioned to be able to transition into a more virtual model. So, you know, honestly, it gave us such great insight into, you know, how to continue to run a very successful business.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, and I'm glad that you weren't one of those people that froze and you actually saw the light at the end of the tunnel. You're like, oh, we can do this virtually. Because even 2009, I mean, yeah, we had like Google and the internet was kind of full swing. But if you think about it, mobile wasn't what mobile is today. I mean, the iPhone had just come out not too long before that. So we were starting to get used to the idea of a smartphone, but they weren't like they are now. I mean, just to pull up something took forever. The apps were shitty. I mean, it's just, even Facebook wasn't fully mobile at the time yet, you know? So I'm glad you went that way. And then you told me in our previous conversation that you pretty much started using ClickFunnels when it opened up, right? Yeah, which is how I did it too.
Yeah, we've actually known Russell forever. Like, I mean, I remember back when he, you know, had his potato gun stuff. Okay.
I never met him back then. Like I know the Russell that you see now, and I met him once for like literally like 30 seconds, like at our Funnel Hacking Live, you know, but obviously cool dude. I mean, I've followed everything he's done and everything by Dan Kennedy and all the guys, you know, DeGrisio and all those guys. So, I mean, it's amazing what he's done. There's no doubt about it. And I learned so much from him, his books too, you know?
Oh my gosh. He's the golden child. And you know what? He's an amazing human being. And there are not a whole lot of internet marketers that have the level of integrity and just caring. And, you know, he really truly is what he said, you know, he is exactly the way he is. And we had the great fortune to be able to work with Russell privately for 3 days.
What was that like?
Anymore, huh?
I want the dirt. What was that like?
There's no dirt. He is
like, no, I mean like the dirt guy. Of like, how cool was that? That's what I mean by that.
It was, I have some pictures. We share these all the time. I have pictures of me behind his desk. You know, we were literally building funnels. Like Russell was building our funnel. Like it was crazy.
That's pretty awesome.
It was really awesome. And we just said, you know, we needed to invest in that. We were members of his Ignite Inner Circle. Mm-hmm. But having 3 days with him and his team was incredibly eye-opening. I mean, the guy he's just so brilliant. He has no limitations, right? He has no limitations. He's an idea machine. It's really brilliant.
You know, it's funny when I first heard the story about him, you know, being into like infomercials and stuff like that since he was a kid, I was like, okay, that's the biggest crock of shit ever. Because I didn't even know who he was yet, but I heard a story through somebody else. Like, oh, this guy that started, I'm like, dude, come on. What kid is sitting there like watching infomercials and be like, I want to do this for a living? Like, no. And then, oh no, totally. I believe it 100% now that I met the guy and I've learned a lot of stuff from him. but it's pretty cool. I've done his 2 Coma Club training, and I mean, that took me to a whole new level. I mean, a whole new level. It wasn't in person in Idaho, but you know, like the actual course itself. And that's what took me to the next level with funnels, actually.
Absolutely.
You know, besides the books, obviously.
He shares it all, man. He puts it all out there. He really does. He sets a great example.
Yeah, so it's good. All right, so you started working, you started building funnels, all that stuff. It went virtually. So, I mean, at first, were you scared? How did you do the research? Or you guys just went full on to the max right away? How did that go?
Well, we had, okay, so from our background, because we had a brick and mortar, but we had always had an online component to our business. We always had. My husband developed the very first CEU accredited nutrition certification program on the market back in 2003, and also the very first custom nutrition software. So we have a full SaaS software program that we do. And he developed, again, those were back in 2003. So we were the first ones on the market. So we were working with clients internationally, literally from 2003. So what we all, basically all we did was shut down our, you know, our in-person, and we put all of our resources and ideas and everything into online. So we just expanded it. And then we had brought on some big corporate clients. So we initially had gone large corporate. We got a 5-year contract with Gold's Gym International. We had a 5-year contract with Max Muscle Stores and some other fitness franchises. Mm-hmm. And we thought, okay, this is great. This is the way to go. And then we realized that we love working with small to medium-sized businesses, that the corporations are just all red tape, and we were doing all the work. They were getting, you know, we were all private labeled basically. And we're like, you know what, let's work with, you know, we were working with franchisees. And as we started working with franchisees, we realized we love that one-on-one interaction. We love helping businesses see what was even more possible. It wasn't just about the software. It wasn't just about the certification. And so I started bringing in more of my business background and my marketing background, along with my husband, who he had also worked with Tony Robbins for 5 years. So he's a master NLP practitioner, and we've always tied in languaging and sales with our whole program. So it became a system. So it's literally like this entire system that you can plug into any health and wellness business. And we realized as we started helping these businesses, they were getting incredible results. So we shifted it's been about 10 years now. So around 2010, we began to shift into more of the business coaching side and really working more with the businesses. So for us, it was just really more about how can we help these guys really stand out in the marketplace? How can we help them be super unique and tie in some of the stuff that nobody else is doing? So we just kind of, you know, it was more of an organic path for us. It really was.
That's really cool. So once you get that, you know, the perfect client, the Gold Gyms and all that stuff, and the franchise owners, like, what is the process like? So when they come to you for help, what is it that you're looking for, and how do you guide them through that path? What's the process like from your end to, you know, to help them basically?
Great. I will tell you, first of all, it is really important. We actually have a pretty intensive consulting call that we do first. And I will tell you one thing, we dive into their pain point first. What is really their challenge? And quite frankly, we have, you know, the conversation we take them through, and we have them rate and scale, you know, how committed are they to making these changes? I'm going to tell you, this is really important. If they don't tell us, I mean, obviously we dive into what are the issues and what are their challenges. If they don't tell us that they're a 10 out of 10 to making these committed changes, like that they really want to do this, we don't take them on as a client. Honestly, if they're a 9, I don't take them on as a client until they're fully, because you know this, like, you know, being an entrepreneur is amazing and it's fantastic, and you have to be committed. Like, you have to be committed.
I can't tell you how many times when I was starting out and, you know, when I was starting out doing it for other people, I had to, you know, bite my tongue and take all these small businesses because to build, you know, a portfolio, right? To build, you know, my portfolio so I can show people. It's like, hey, I've done it plenty of times. And one of the biggest issues that I constantly had with small businesses is that they will get cold feet. I will say, hey, we need to run ads for this long and it's gathering data. And I promise you, and this is back like 2012, where it was like $5 and whatever, you know, it's like, and people still got cold feet. And I'm like, dude, you don't understand. Like once I grab this manipulate it and take advantage of it, it's going to like triple your revenue and they will just get cold feet. And that's because I didn't pre-qualify. Like you said, I didn't do any pre-qualifying because I was desperate to help other people. And then I learned very quickly that it takes the same amount of work to get a small business client than it takes to get a whole freaking corporation that does not care about their money. And they go, spend all of it so we get more. You know, it's like, those are my dream clients because they need more budget for the next year. But obviously they still need results, but it's a different mindset. It's like, okay, cool. Yeah, go for it. You know, as long as you show those numbers. So yeah, now I pre-qualify as well. So I can see why you're pre-qualifying as well to make sure you're real with any of that.
They have to be really ready, you know, ready, and you know, they're ready to make these changes because, again, ultimately, we're helping them design a lifestyle business that they will ultimately get to the place where what their vision is. But they got to do the work on the front end, and they have to be committed to wanting to do that because we can't want it for them more than they want it for themselves.
Right.
And that's really sort of the first step. Is making sure that they are ready to do the work because honestly, like, it's disappointing for us when they just sort of splitter off. You know, we want them to get these amazing results. You know, so that's obviously the first step, and then it's also just an intake process of seeing. We look at everything. We look at their numbers. Where are they at? What are they doing? What are they not doing? We have a whole process that we take them through on questionnaire, so we just get an idea of, you know, what do they do in their business or not do. I'm going to tell you, I cannot tell you how many small business owners have no concept in tracking their money. Like, I know.
I've had this conversations a million times. Okay. What's your CPA? What's your average order value? What's your lifetime value per client? Crickets.
No idea.
Crickets.
And most of them, like, they don't know what they're bringing in each month. They don't know what their regular monthly revenue incomes are. Like, they don't know any of this. They don't track it. And I mean, so again, we're talking many times, it's basic business foundations. And we start off with a strong business foundation. We take all of our clients through it. And I'll even tell you, we had a client who was in business for 30 years. They had a world-class powerlifting gym. Okay, incredible. They literally had powerlifters come in from all over the world because they had equipment that nobody else had. They had no clue on how to market or do their business. They did track their income and they kind of had an idea, but as far as marketing and packaging and branding, and they had no clue on this. In 6 weeks, we increased their income 9% because we were adamant about numbers. And in less than 12 months, so it was a 12 months that we worked with them, increased 34% in their revenue.
Just with marketing?
Just from a variety of the things that we helped them implement the foundational components of a business. They just had this gym and people were coming and like they had no idea. So it was marketing, it was branding. We did a lot of work on branding them and truly getting them recognized. They had no branding whatsoever. They were a mishmash of all kinds of stuff. Now they're like, you see their brand everywhere. If you know, you see it on all of, you know, they do powerlifting meets that are televised, and they had nothing there to make them stand out from any other, you know, look different than any other gym. Now we have everything branded. Everything's marketed under that. They are known. They are known worldwide. And now they just have this incredible, you know, again, just a draw to their company that they never had.
So obviously you're doing everything from branding, marketing, and all that stuff to get people through the door. Okay, so once you set the foundations, how do you get through their heads? Because, I have had the issues before. It's like, well, that does not go with the brand. I was like, you don't have a brand. You don't even have a brand right now. What do you mean it doesn't go with the brand? You know what I mean? Like stuff like that. So how do you guys deal with that? Because I feel like big businesses, they have certain guidelines they stick to, right? And they're very careful about the moves that they make because of corporate red tape. But then with the small businesses, small to mid-sized businesses, I find that the owners are emotionally attached to it, which to me, it's a big, big mistake. Never get emotionally attached to your business. I mean, be proud of it, be your biggest cheerleader, take it to the top, but you cannot get emotionally attached to it. You got to be able to pivot. You got to be able to change. You got to be able to take suggestions. So how do you, what's the word looking for? how do you present that to them when you're making like such big changes so it doesn't like insult them? You know what I mean? Because I find that those conversations are delicate. So how do you guys go about that process?
I call that the marshmallow sandwich.
Okay. I love that.
I do. It's the marshmallow sandwich, right? You nice something nice, you know, you lead into it, you acknowledge where they're at and what they've done. Uh-huh. You give them the cold hard truth. And I'm also, we're really clear with our clients up front that, look, we're going to be really straight up with you. We're going to do it in a nice manner, but I'm not going to beat around the bush. This is about business, right? This is a business decision. But I do what I call the marshmallow sandwich, right? I lead into it with something like, look, I acknowledge what you've done up to this point. And I always use the word and, not but. And
that's a good one.
Here is what you need to focus on. Right. These are the changes. This is what we recommend for you. This is ultimately your business. But I want you to understand why we are making these recommendations. And then marshmallow on the back end as well. Just, now it's up to you and blah, blah, blah. But I am we're both very upfront with our clients from the very get-go that says, and I have to sometimes learn their languaging patterns because I've had a couple clients they get upset or I can't do anything right. I'm like, this is not about right or wrong. This is just about business. Okay. You need to understand to listen. I'm not negating what you've done up to this point. I'm not criticizing you. This is strictly business. Like, look at it with a business mind. How can we improve upon what you have? And once I have, again, if I have someone who's, I do have a client right now who in the beginning was pretty sensitive to it. And I get them on a private call and I said, look, I want you to understand, I'm not criticizing you. Okay? I'm not criticizing you at all. She has a brilliant, oh my gosh, like she has such a unique niche market, absolutely niche. And she just doesn't know how to communicate that. And so she thought I was criticizing her where it was completely opposite. I was helping, I just said, look, you need to understand I'm helping you to improve here. Okay. I'm not saying, wrong. This is what you have and how can you do better? And once we had that conversation, she started to take it less. She thought I was attacking her personally, which I'm not at all, right. But I don't have, look, we're here to like get these changes happening. And it's not something that happens overnight. It takes, it's an evolution.
And I think people get hung up on the whole idea of I have to be completely different from anybody else to be successful. And that's not really the case. I used to think like that too. I mean, listen, unless you come up with Uber before there was an Uber or Amazon before there was an Amazon, sure, go the other way. But let's face it, when it comes to stuff like this, there's a reason why most companies do it a certain way. And you just got to learn how to do that for yourself with your own messaging and, your own branding and all that good stuff. So, okay. So let's get into sales though, because I grew up in hardcore sales.
Okay.
I was brick and mortar too. Cold calling, knocking on doors, growing up working in retail. So I've been in sales my whole life. And then I learned from some of the best too in my 20s. So when you go in there, there's always a sales manager who's going to be an asshole. How do you deal with those? And how do you go in there revamping their whole sales process?
Well, I have to tell you, honestly, in our industry and our business, I would say 98% of the time, we don't have that issue. Honestly, we don't in our industry. Mostly what we're working with are sole practitioners or small businesses or franchises, and we're dealing with the business owners. So the business owner is our client, not the managers. So we are ultimately working with them. Now we had like for that, from the gym that had been around for 30 years, they basically came in and said, look, you guys, these are our business. This is our business team. They're going to come in. They're going to take a look at everything. We went in, we literally went in person up there to see and to look at all the numbers and do everything. But they were cool because, again, they respected the owners and we never.
So there was no pushback from the sales team or anything like that?
Mm-mm. No, we haven't because, we're not working more on the corporate level anymore, right? Mm-hmm. We're not really dealing with that. We're dealing more with the small and mediums. Most of our clients are either, gym owners, yoga studios, nutrition stores. We work with a lot of nutrition stores. We work with chiropractors, naturopath doctors, and then we get like health coaches and fitness coaches. So generally, again, we're looking at pretty small teams that they have, if any. And so I've been really fortunate. We don't really have to deal with that. Now, if we do, My husband is the master NLP practitioner. So
that is true. That is true. You brought out that point. NLP, baby.
He's really, you know, he comes from a corporate background as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, he'll deal with those things. Plus, you know. That's awesome.
All right. That's cool. So for those of you listening or watching right now, you know, if they're just getting started and they don't have the money to hire someone like you and your team to come in and revamp everything for them, what are the absolute things they must know or they must do to get started and just at least be in the right direction? So when they're ready to scale and bring a team like yours on, you know, what do they need to focus on to get to that point?
Great question. So I know you and I think this came up on the last podcast that we were on together. I always tell someone starting out again, and again, my focus primarily the small to medium sized entrepreneur is to either outsource or have support teams, have teams that specialize in different areas that are not your area of expertise. So whether that's a social media manager, whether that is if you're creating maybe Facebook groups or you're doing some online training, like course stuff, like have someone who can manage the technical side if you're not technical. Have somebody who can create graphics for you if you're not a graphics person. Like, this is really basic stuff. But I know, like, you know, again, I tell my clients this all the time because they'll spend 10 hours trying to do one graphic. And I'm like, come on. Like,
why are you doing that?
5 minutes. Yeah. Why are you doing that? You need to be focused on clients, getting clients, bringing on clients, servicing your clients. That's it. Right. So it's all about outsourcing or creating a team. So we talked about this before. I love my teams. Like, you know, there's certain things I love to do and I do the things I love to do and what I need to do. But we talked about this, like our teams are international now, the way we work, right? I have a team in Australia, my A team in Australia. I call them my A team because I love working with the Australians, but Australia, the Philippines, Belarus, the UK, the US, and I know there's someone, I always forget, but because they're everywhere, I don't really remember where they are.
No, we talked about this. I'm the same way. Yeah. I talked about it, you know, in this channel and other videos and other podcasts before. It's like, listen, if you're a small business owner and you're at that point where like, okay, I need to scale so I can bring somebody like Lisa here to help me out, you know, the first thing you got to concentrate on is sales and marketing. I mean, and if between the two, sales, then marketing, right?
Absolutely.
Without sales, you have nothing. You know, if you have too many sales, you can always fix it by paying somebody to do whatever it is that you need done.
Yeah.
But it's not the other way around. If you try to concentrate on like the little things like graphic design and, you know, whatever, then there's no sales coming in. So you need a pipeline that's full 24/7.
We have a thing with, especially for our newer, like if you're a new entrepreneur, or you're just trying to figure this out or you're getting started, we have a thing called getting 5 clients fast. That is, obviously, once they're clear on who they serve and the problem that they solve, it's about getting 5 client fans. You don't need a website. Like, you don't, like this day, like you got Facebook, right? Like, you don't even need a website. You don't need that. You need clients. You need those sales.
So I didn't have a consulting website for years. You know, you guys want to know why I have webs now? Because my biggest clients beg me to build one. So they have something to show someone. I'm like, all right, I guess I'll get it done. But I don't send traffic to the websites. I don't do anything with them. You know, if I want leads, I have my funnels, you know, that I run with ads and all that stuff.
Exactly.
People don't get that. Exactly. They're all scared.
Yeah, I never even, like, I don't send anything to our website. Like, that's just.
No.
We've had it since 2003. So I guess that's why. But I totally agree that you must have sales up front. Sales is what's going to generate everything. We teach something called the core entrepreneurial process. So it's the business cycle. I'm off the screen. Wait,
there you go. I can see you. We can see you.
And again, in the business cycle, step one is getting clarity, right? We talk about getting super clear who you serve, what the problem is you solve. Step two, get 5 clients fast. That is step two every single time. I don't even care if you're an established business, but making sure that the concept that you have is a viable concept, right? People want it and that it generates income. After that, then you can get into the marketing and the branding and all the other components, but you need cash flow to run a business.
And there's no excuse now. Like people, especially like young, I'm an old millennial because I'm right on that line, but you know, young millennials, Gen Z, they're afraid of the phone. I was like, dude, you know how many calls I used to make a day? Over 100.
Really?
Right? I used to call like at least 100 people a day when I had my business, when I was getting it going. And it sucks. I didn't enjoy it, but that's how I got my clients. And now you have LinkedIn, you have Google, you have everything. I didn't have Google at the time. Back then it was the Yellow Pages, get you some. Like I couldn't even like, I mean, Google was around, but you didn't have all the information like we have now. So, and they're not picking up the phone. It's like, all you have to do is go to LinkedIn, stalk them a little bit, and you can get all their information. Just pick up the phone and call them. Listen.
I love that you mentioned that because literally like this, we were actually going back. You guys, it's old school, man. It works because everyone's on information overload. What is a different way of capturing their attention? We literally just ran, we're running a, you know, we have an event coming up and we just ran a list yesterday of all the phone numbers that we have. And my husband and I, because we're both, you know, really good on the phone, we're like, all right, run the list. Here's what we have. Split the list. Boom. Well, how do we break it up over how many days I have to make 10 calls a day? Great. Hit that list. Boom. Just picking up the phone. And again, we go back to the basics because they work.
Yeah. And if you call and they don't pick up the phone, call back 3 times in a row. They'll pick up the phone. If they're not in a meeting or something, trust me. And they'll recognize the number the 4th time. So they'll pick it up at some point.
Oh, that's good.
That's awesome. Well, Lisa, thank you so much for coming on. We're already out of time. This is crazy. When am I like 2 minutes? It feels like 2 minutes. It's already been half an hour. Thank you so much for coming on. For those that want to work with you, where can they find you? Obviously, I'm going to have all the links in the description, but so they know, where should they go?
Yeah, absolutely. You have the link in the description. Easiest way to find me is actually Facebook. I spell my name a little weird, so it's exactly as you see it on here. Lisa, L-I-S-C-A, the middle initial L, Crisali. That's the easiest way to find me. However, you'll have some links on there. We are hosting our annual upcoming conference. It's going to be a virtual experience, which I am super excited about.
That's cool.
We are throwing down on this one, which we always do, but it's going to be super cool doing it virtually. We've been doing this for 10 years. And it is, you know, it's the beginning of December. So for our industry, that's the slow time in business, which is the time to invest in yourself and invest in your business. It's a business focus. It is not a pitch-a-thon. We do not have 30 speakers throwing their shit down. Oh, excuse me.
No, you can curse. It shit, is throwing their shit down and pitching you. Good.
Throwing their shit down and pitching you, right? This is work on your business, come out with a plan and implement. So we're really excited about that. So that's called the Monetize Your Nutrition Knowledge virtual experience. You have the link to that. That's probably the best way. And there's several others in there. I have some free gifts for your listeners as well. We have a free business resource list, actually. You have all kinds of access to business resources in there. That's absolutely free for your listeners. You guys can go in there to that link and just check that all out. That's also a great way.
All right, cool. So all links will be down in the description. So make sure you check those out. Help support the channel. Help support Lisa. She's giving you a bunch of free stuff, man.
I love giving you free stuff.
If you're listening on the podcast, make sure you subscribe. If you're on YouTube, same, subscribe, like the video because it helps with the algo. And Lisa, again, thank you so much for coming on. I really enjoyed this and hopefully I'll have you back on soon.
I would love that. You and I, you know, we're going to continue talking. So
yes, we are. We are. All right. Thank you so much.
Work on.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
Awesome.